اللهم ربنا اغفر لنا ذنوبنا وارحمنا واهدنا وزدنا علما اللهم ربنا علمنا بما ينفعنا وانفعنا بما علمتنا وجعلنا من عبادك الصالحين بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم عن سعد ابن أبي الوقاص سعد ابن أبي وقاص was a صحابي who entered Islam very early on there's hadith عن سعد ابن أبي وقاص he said that I was at a certain point I was a third part I was third of the Islam. Third of the Islam was this man. He entered the Islam after Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anhu wa Zayd ibn Haritha, which is we learned that his name was used to be, after it was changed, was Zayd ibn Muhammad, Mawla Rasulullah alayhi salatu wasalam. He was the third person, right? And he was the uncle of Rasulullah alayhi salatu wasalam from his mother's side, from Bani Zuhra. Bani Zuhra is from Quraysh. So he was the cousin of his mother, of Amina. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give us all, inshallah, the huda and the guidance, inshallah. Sa'd ibn Abi al-Waqqas was a very pious person. And Rasulullah alayhi salatu wa salam used to be proud of him. He used to say, one time he was sitting down and he saw him coming by. And he says, this is hadha khali. فَأَرِينِي أَحَدُكُمْ أَيْنَ خَالَهُ You know, that's my uncle. Let one of you show me his uncle. So how proud he is. Look at the sweet words of Rasulullah alayhi salatu wasalam for the Sahaba. Sa'd ibn al-Waqqas, when he entered Islam, he was very strong and he was a great archer. He used to throw, And he was always proud that Rasulullah alayhi salatu wasalam is the only person that supposedly, and this hadith on Ali ibn Abi Talib, the only person that Rasulullah alayhi salatu wasalam said, Bi abi anta wa ummi to fidaka abi wa ummi. Rasulullah alayhi wasalam said it to one person, is this man, Sa'd ibn Abi al-Waqqas, in the battle of Uhud. In the battle of Uhud, what happened is that it was big chaos, the Muslims spread, and Rasulullah alayhi wasalam was standing alone, almost alone. There's a few of the Sahaba with him. It was Sa'd ibn Abi al-Waqqas was there. So Rasulullah used to, and he was the great archer, he used to throw with the arrow. So he used to hand him the arrow, and you say, Irmi fadaka ummi wa abi. You know, is that he's making dua for him, and this is an old habit that for the Arab used to say, is that I will sacrifice my mother and my father for your sake, you know, just throw. And Rasulullah made dua for him, of two things. He was a great thrower, and his dua was mustajab. His dua, his supplication, was answered by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala because of his iman. And as a matter of fact, he said one time to him, saddal Allahu ramyak, and he made dua for him. Saddal Allahu ramyak, wa ajab Allahu dua'ak. Aw kama qala Rasulullah alayhi salatu wasalam. That you make your throw, you know, be bullseye to make your throw correct, and make your dua to be answered by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. That's why, no. Told Sa'd, no. Rasulullah alayhi salatu wasalam, only one that Rasulullah alayhi salatu wasalam told Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas. One time, and this is the only time we know of, that Rasulullah alayhi salatu wasalam said it to somebody, it was Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas. That's him, that's the man. So you can imagine how valuable that is. Can you imagine that Rasulullah alayhi salatu wasalam telling somebody, a man, you know, even from Sahaba, telling him, you know, fadaka abi wa ummi. This is a big deal, huge deal. And we always see these signs from Rasulullah alayhi salam. Remember we said a hadith when one time he came to Sa'd ibn Jabal. What did he say to him? He says, Inni uhibbuka fillah. I love you for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Sa'd ibn Jabal, ya Rasulullah, you love me for the sake of, I love you for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You know, you love me. You see? Now he told him the same thing to Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas. Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas survived Rasulullah alayhi salatu wasalam and died many, many years later, almost 40 years, like in the year 54 Hijri. So this is a beautiful hadith. This hadith in Bab, in the heading of Ritha'u al-Muslim. Ritha'u al-Muslim. There is something that we do here in the culture, in the non-Muslim culture, what we say is something called eulogy. Eulogize somebody. When somebody die, you go to his funeral and you make a big gathering and somebody stands up and eulogizes to somebody. The eulogy is basically to tell his good qualities, to say something has happened with this guy and, you know, he's so-and-so, did that. That's not part of the Islamic culture. But the question is that we get to ask ourselves, are we allowed to mention somebody who is dead with a good way or a bad way, or are we allowed to mention him at all? Exactly. So this is from the Bab. We tell their good deeds, good actions, good behavior. We talk about it and we make dua for them, but we don't mention the bad stuff that they used to do. We don't mention it at all. We don't even talk about it. We mention about the good stuff. And look what happened here. Now, this is the hadith. كان رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم يعودني عام حجة الوداع. The حجة الوداع, what happened is that رسول الله عليه الصلاة والسلام migrated back. How many times did رسول الله عليه السلام make حج, حجة? One time, exactly. And that was حجة الوداع. When he made the famous speech and he says, اليوم أتممت لكم دينكم ورضيت لكم إسلام دينا إلى آخره, right? That was the one time he made حجة. سعد بن أبي وقاص migrated with رسول الله عليه الصلاة والسلام from مكة to Medina. So when the Hajj has happened, he went with Rasulullah alayhi salatu wasalam back to Mecca. But when he was in Mecca during the Hajj, Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas got sick. He was severely sick, bad. So he was sick. Rasulullah alayhi salatu wasalam went to him to visit him. This is the awda. This is what he says. Ya'uduni 'aam Hajj al-Wada. Hajj al-Wada in year 9, 1 year before Rasulullah alayhi salam passed away. حجة الوداع من وجع اشتد بي. He got a severe pain inside. He says, I had severe pain. I was sick from it. Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم came in to visit me. Right? So, فقلت إني قد بلغ مني من الوجع. He said, سعد بن الوقاص said to رسول الله عليه الصلاة والسلام. He said, يا رسول الله, I have severe pain. A lot of pain. وأنا ذو مال. ولا يرثني إلا بنة أفأتصدق بثلث مالي. He says, I am in severe pain and I don't have any kids. I don't have anybody to inherit me. I have a daughter. Can I give away? I just have this daughter. Can I give away sadaqah for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Third of my money. Rasulullah alayhi salatu wasalam, he says, I'm sorry, I apologize. بثلثي مالي, two-thirds of my money. So the way he was thinking, Sa'd ibn Waqqas thinking, I only have a daughter and I have money. And he's thinking of himself, he's going to die. So he says, can I give sadaqah, two-thirds of my money and leave one-third to my daughter? Rasulullah alayhi salatu wasalam said, no. He went back again. فقلت بالشطر. And I said to him, half, shatr is half. Rasulullah alayhi salatu wasalam said, no. لا. ثم قال الثلث, only one third, والثلث كثير. This is sunnah from Rasulullah عليه الصلاة والسلام. He says, give away one third and even the one third is too much. See? So when somebody on his deathbed, that is not the time for you to give, start giving away. You know? And that is the sunnah. Most of the scholars said, according to this hadith, and this hadith was mentioned in the other books of, you know, sadaqah and inheritance and all this and that, that most of the scholars said that if you are on your deathbed, you should not give away the maximum, and that is maximum, is a third of your money. Don't go beyond that, right? And there was many hadith on this, the advantages of not giving away more than a third, you know, but this is not the heading that we're talking about today. And then Rasulullah alayhi salatu wasalam continued. He says, إِنَّكَ إِنْتَذَرْ وَرَثَتَكَ أَغْنِيَاءَ خَيْرٌ مِّنْ أَنْتَذَرْهُمْ عَالَةً يَتَكَفَّفُونَ النَّاسِ. And for you to leave your inheritors, the one who inherits you, أغْنِيَاء, rich, better for you to leave them. You know, better for you to leave them. أنتظرهم عالة. They are a burden on others. They ask him other people to give you. It's better for you to leave them rich rather than for you to leave them a burden on others for them to ask money from others, right? وَإِنَّكَ لَن تُنْفِقَ نَفَقَةً تَبْتَغِي بِهَا وَجْهُ اللَّهِ إِلَّا أُجِرْتَ بِهَا. Remember that any nafaqah, any money you give for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will reward you for it. حتى ما تجعلوا في امرأتك, even what you leave in your with your wife. See the meaning here, that when you leave something for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, as a good pious Muslim will do, will leave in his inheritance to his wife, to his daughters, that is for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, to make sure they have money to spend and they are not burdened on others for others to spend money on them. Right? Alhamdulillah. So, Qultu, Sa'd ibn al-Waqas said, Ya Rasulullah, أخلف بعد أصحابي. Would I, you know, and the meaning here, أخلف مستوثقاً, he says, would I be still alive after my ashab, after my, you know, the companions will go away, will die, will pass away? Rasulullah عليه الصلاة والسلام answered him back. He says, إنك لن تخلف فتعمل عملا صالحا إلا استدت به درجة رفيعة. And Rasulullah did not answer him back, did not tell him that you're going to live longer. But he told him, he says, if you're going to live longer, and any deed that you do, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will raise you higher in the Jannah, you know, in the status that you have in the Jannah. Thumma, and then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Rasulullah said, La'allaka, maybe, watch, he gave the prediction, La'allaka, أن تخلف حتى ينتفع بك أقوام. You know, you will be left behind until some people, أقوام, people, will benefit from you. ويضر بك آخرون, and others, they will be harmed by you. That is the prediction of Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Rasulullah صلى الله عليه وسلم made dua. It says, اللهم, he said, and then he made the dua. Rasulullah عليه الصلاة والسلام made the dua. And he says, made the dua, Allahumma amdi li ashabi hijratahum. And then this dua that he asked Allah, Rasulullah alayhi salatu wasalam, making dua to for Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas and the rest of the Sahaba, he says, Ya Allah, fix or give my ashab, my companions, the full reward for the hijrah, for the migration that they have done, you know, from that day. وَلَا تَرُدَّهُمْ عَلَىٰ أَقَابِهِمْ, and do not turn them back on their, you know, turn back from where they're at. لَكِنَّ الْبَائِسِ, who's the really the miserable one? Rasulullah ﷺ says, وَلَكِنَّ الْبَائِسِ هُوَ سَعْدُ بْنُ خَوْلَىٰ. There's one man, his name is سَعْدُ بْنُ خَوْلَىٰ. He's the ba'is, he's the miserable one. يرثي له رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم. رسول الله صلى الله عليه وسلم mentioned him, and in a way making dua for سعد بن خولة, and because he died in Mecca. This again, let's understand something from this hadith. رسول الله عليه الصلاة والسلام in حجة الوداع in the year 9, he was visiting سعد بن أبي وقاص. سعد بن أبي وقاص, he was so sick, he thought he was going to die. He thought he was on his deathbed. So Rasulullah visited him in his sickness, and he Sa'd ibn Waqqas asked him the question. He says, Ya Rasulullah, can I give away 2/3 of my money? I only have a daughter. Rasulullah said, no. He says, how about half? He says, no. He says, give a third, and a third is too much. It's better for you to leave your children or your inheritors to be rich rather than for you to leave them poor. They're asking people, you know, to leave them burden on others to ask for money, right? And then Rasulullah Sa'd ibn al-Waqas, he asked him the question. He says, would I stay behind, you know, after the companions, they were all going to go away, I will stay behind? Or in other words, he's asking him, am I going to live, or this is my deathbed, this is it, you know, what's going to happen? So Rasulullah alayhi salatu wasalam answered him back. He says, you will not do a deed, إِنَّكَ لَن تُخَلَّفَ فَتَعْمَلَ عَمَلًا صَالِحًا إِلَّا اسْتَدْتَ بِهِ دَرَجَةً وَرِفَعًا. If you live behind, every deed you do, everything you do, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will raise you in the heavens, another degree, another, you know, you go up on the ladder. And then maybe you're going to stay behind, and you're going to be doing a lot of benefits for some people, you're going to be doing a lot of harms for other people. That's from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Rasulullah alayhi salam made dua, Allahumma amdi li ashabi hijratahum. Ya Allah, give the full reward for my ashab, for my sahab, for companions, because they migrated from Mecca to Medina. What was the worry of Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas here? Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas, what happened is that when people migrated, and that was 9 years earlier, when people migrated with Rasulullah from Makkah to Medina, Sa'd ibn Waqqas, he was in the Hajj, he was making Hajj, and he thought he's going to die in Makkah. And he's thinking to himself, I migrated to Medina, and now I'm back to Makkah, I'm going to die in Makkah. Would I be rewarded for my migration to Makkah, to Medina, from Makkah to Medina? Would I get rewarded for it or not? That was one of the concerns of Sa'd ibn Waqqas. And so Rasulullah, he says, no, you will live, and maybe Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is going to give you the reward for what you're going to do. And he made mention to a man, his name Sa'd ibn Khawla. This man, Sa'd ibn Khawla, there's stories not clear about him exactly what has happened with him. But it's been said that when he migrated from Mecca to Medina, and it's been said that when at a certain point he went back to Mecca, and he was forced for one reason or another, he ended up staying in Mecca, did not go back, did not continue on with his migration, did not go back to Rasulullah, and he ended up dying in Mecca. So basically, his hijrah, his migration was nulled and voided because he migrated and then he went back. So that was, Wallahu A'lam, this is the Sa'd ibn Khawla, what has happened with him. But Rasulullah mentions him in a good way. He says, may Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, that is the one who is miserable of what has happened to him. May Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala forgive his sins for something has happened with Sa'd ibn Khawla. Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas lived 40 years after this incident, has been said in it, 40 years. And he lived many, many, many years. And he was in part of the armies in Bilad al-Sham, and he did a lot of actions, a lot of deeds. I remember the dua of Rasulullah, he made dua for him. He says, saddid ramyahu wa ajib dua'a. Two things. He says, make his aim, make his target to be accurate, to be good, and make his dua, his supplication to be answered. So one time, and it's been said that one time, this is, to give you an example about him, what has happened with him. One time there was this man who was mentioning some of the Sahaba in a bad way, Zubayr ibn Awam, some other Sahaba. He's saying, oh, these Sahaba did this, this, this. So he looked at him, he says, if you don't stop, I'm going to make dua, for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to punish me. This man looks at him, he says, you're talking to me like you're a prophet? You're telling me this? And he continued on, doing injustice, doing transgression against the two Sahaba. So Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas, he goes, he makes wudu, he makes two rak'ah, he says, ya Allah, he makes dua. He says, ya Allah, if this man is doing something bad, he should be stopped, ya Allah, stop him. And if he's doing something right, ya Allah, leave him alone. So he finished up his salah, he finished up his dua. And supposedly this man was in the market. Then the one who narrated the hadith is saying, he said, we saw a camel coming in from the edge of the market, running like a crazy camel, running and people getting out of the way. And he headed right to this man. He just went right on top of him. He pushed him and he stumbled all over him and he killed him right there on the spot. That is Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas, an amazing character. The uncle, one of the uncles of Rasulullah alayhi salatu wasalam. This is the man when one time Rasulullah alayhi salatu wasalam, he was sitting in his room and he says, maybe a good pious person, a rajul mu'min, a pious person, will come in and guard us. He was saying this. And then all of a sudden, they hear, the knocking of weapons and, clinking of metals and stuff like that. He looks up, who's there? He says, Ana Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas. He said, I am Sa'd ibn Abi Waqqas. He says, I'm here to guard you, to be at the door of Rasulullah. And Aisha radiallahu anha, Ummu al-Mu'mineen, she narrated the hadith. She says, I could hear Rasulullah alayhi salatu wasalam in deep sleep. Subhanallah. Look at the work of these people before us, inshallah. Alhamdulillah. We move on to next hadith, inshallah. This hadith on Abdul Rahman ibn Abi Layla. This is the bab under the heading of من قام لجنازة يهودي, whomever stood up for the funeral of a Jewish man, of a Jewish person. What we say under the heading of to stand up, respect for the funeral of a non-Muslim. This is the heading that we should be talking about. Abdul Rahman ibn Abi Layla is Tabi'i. He was Tabi'i. Tabi'i is the one who listened, who saw, who witnessed, or he was in the company of Sahabi. His name Tabi'i, right? We talked about that. Kana Sahlu ibn Hunayf. Sahlu ibn Hunayf wa Qays ibn Sa'd. Two of the Sahaba were sitting down. Who is Qays ibn Sa'd? Qays ibn Sa'd is Qays ibn Sa'd ibn Ubadah. Do you remember the Sa'dain? The two Sa'dain. Sa'd ibn Mu'adh wa Sa'd ibn Ubadah. Sa'd ibn Mu'adh is Sayyidu al-Aws. And Sa'd ibn Ubadah, Sayyidu al-Khazraj, is the head of the two tribes in Medina. And two of the heads, the leaders, is Sa'd ibn Mu'adh, which is the one who passed away after the Battle of Uhud. And he was, if you remember, he was cut, with his vein, and he ended up passing away. And this is the hadith of Rasulullah ﷺ, that Arshul Rahman ihtaz, shook from happiness of meeting this creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, Sa'd ibn Mu'adh. He died in that after the battle in a few days. Sa'd ibn Ubadah was the leader of the other tribe. His son was Qays, very tall, very handsome man. And people looked at him as he's their leader, even though he was very young. And he grew up to be their leader even later. And they admitted it because his father and his grandfather, they were one of the greatest leaders of their own tribe. They always respected them. They always, gave him the highest regard. And Qays ibn Sa'd ibn Ubadah was completely hairless, had no beard whatsoever, got no hair on his head, on his face. The Khazraj used to say, he says, wallahi, if we could buy a beard and put it on his face, we would have bought it. This is a mention to the fact that a beard is a form of zina, a beautification for a man, right? Do you remember when Aisha radiallahu anha, she used to make dua? He says, walladhi, by the one who والذي زين الرجال باللحى, by the one, I swear by the one who made, beautified the man with his beard, subhanallah. And we see the beards, they go in fashion, out of fashion. Sometimes they become fashionable. Everybody, all the women say, oh, this is a good looking guy, you got a nice thick beard. And some of them are, no, that's too much hair, let's just trim it all off. So it's a form of zina, it's a form of, So, and he was very tall. He was very generous. Qays ibn Sa'd ibn Ubadah, he was not just a leader because of his, because of his lineage. He was also because of his daha. He was very smart and he was a very great leader. And at a certain point when he was 17 or 18 years old, he said something. He says, wallahi, lawla al-Islam, without Islam, laja'altu min al-daha daha'an kabiran. Daha kabir, I would have done some things, would have drive people crazy, But Islam, when Islam entered his heart, it straightened him out. He only did the good deeds, good actions. He was so generous. His father, Sa'd ibn Ubadah, when the Sahaba, the people in Medina, they used to host people. Everybody used to host one person, two person, three persons. Sa'd ibn Ubadah used to host 80 people in one shot. His father used to send people to call up in the mountains everywhere. He says, anybody wants shahmu al-lahm, anybody wants meat and fat, come over to our tent, to our part of the city. People used to go, well, who is this man? So one time in one of the ghazwat, Sa'd ibn Abi Waqas was the leader. In that ghazwa, 300 of the Muslims was with them. Qays ibn Sa'd ibn Ubadah was with them as well. And it was very bad time. People did not have any food. So he had a few camels. Every day he slaughters three camels and he feeds the people. The second day, another three camels. The third day, three camels. People are eating. And then he ran out. He doesn't have anything to give. So he borrowed. He goes to the, can I borrow? I'll give it back to you in Medina. He borrows three camels, he slaughters them. Three more camels, he slaughters. And then Sa'd ibn Abu Qas, he said, you gotta stop. So, what are you doing? Look at this guy. He's giving. He ran out of money, he borrows to give, Eventually, until they reached the beach, and there was a big hoot, there was a big whale,
and they sat by by that beach for a while, and they were eating from the meat from that hoot. When they went back to Rasulullah, he said, "Ya Rasulullah, look at this man, what he did." He said, "What did he say about him?" He says, "Innahu min qawmin jood." He is from people, very generous people. Very tall person, right? There's an incident was mentioned in Al-Bidayah wal-Nihayah. Bidayah al-Nihayah is the Ibn Kathir, the book of Ibn Kathir about the history. What happened is that when Muawiyah ibn Abu Sufyan was the wali, or he was the Khalifa, there was a battle was about to happen, between the Rome, the Roman, and the Muslim Empire at the time, the Muslim, you know, country. So the leader of the Roman, he said, "You know what, let's avoid the war. Let's do something." So he sends to Muawiyah ibn Abu Sufyan. He says, "Look, I'm going to send you two people from my people, my group. One of them is very strong, one of them is very tall, very able. If your people can beat my people, you know, I'll give you 3 years of hidna, of truce, no fighting for 3 years." Muawiyah ibn Sufyan, he said, "Yeah, we'll agree to this. Who are we going to call? You need a very tall, very able Muslim man, and very strong, you know, very strong one to meet these two guys. At least we can just, for war not to happen." So he looked around, he said, "Oh, you got to have this guy. His name, Qais ibn Sa'd ibn Ubad, you got to call him. He's the tallest guy around, you know." And he said, "Who's the strong one?" He says, "Muhammad ibn Hanafiya." Muhammad ibn al-Hanafiyya. Who's Muhammad ibn al-Hanafiyya? He's the son of Ali ibn Abi Talib from another woman. Her name is Hanafiyya, not Fatima radiallahu anha. He was another son from a different mother. He's the son of Ali. Very strong guy. We all know Ali ibn Abi Talib, mashallah, he was very strong. So the story says that they met. So Muhammad al-Hanafiyya, he looks at the Roman guy. He says, "Look, I'm going to sit. If you can move me, you know, do whatever." So he sat down on the ground, kind of like a Roman wrestler, you know, this is what they do. One of them lay down, the other one tried to move him. So he sat down on the ground, and the Roman guy came and he tried to move him, tried, you know, shake him, move him, kind of like a sumo wrestler, tried, you know, shake him out of place. He couldn't. He gave up. So he said, "You give up?" He said, "Fine." He says, "My turn." He said, he turns around. He told him, "You sit down." He sat down. He lifted him one time, he threw him out. He says, "Okay, that's it. You win. Alhamdulillah, that's it." Who's the other person? Is Qais ibn Sa'd ibn Ubadah. Qais ibn Sa'd ibn Ubadah, he looks, he met the other guy, he says, "Hold on for a second." He says, "Okay, fine." He said, "Turn the other way." He turned around. He was wearing pants. He says, he took off his pants. He's wearing something underneath, obviously. He took off his pants. He says, "You put them on." The other guy put them on, came out to about right here. He says, "Oh, you win. That's it. Alhamdulillah." This is a true story from the history. You'll do anything for you not to spill blood, to have truce. The idea is not to go kill and spill blood, and you know, it's the opposite. The preservation of life at any cost. This man, Qais ibn Sa'd. Both of them, he says, كَانَ سَهْلُ بْنُ حُنَيْفٍ وَقَيْسُ بْنُ سَعْدْ قَاعِدَيْنِ فِي الْبِالْقَادِسِيَّةِ فِي in the area it's called Qadisiyah. That is the area where a huge battle has happened there. It's about 15 miles or so next to Basra in the south of Iraq. It's a very well-known place. فَمَرُّ عَلَيْهَا بِجِنَازَةٍ فَقَامَ Janaza, a funeral was passing by. They both stood up. فَقِيلَ لَهُمَا إِنَّهُمَا مِنْ أَهْلِ الْأَرْضِ They said to them, "This is one man is from the, you know, just a man. He's not a Muslim, he's nobody. He's just مِنْ أَهْلِ الْأَرْضِ He's from the occupants of earth. Just a man. أي من أهل الذمة. What we say is that, you know, at the time, because Muslims and non-Muslims, people always say, "He's just a regular man. He's not like, you know, somebody that you stand up for." They answered back. They said, "Inna Nabiyya sallallahu alayhi wa sallam marrat bihi janazatun faqam." They said, they both said, Rasulullah alayhi salatu wa salam, he was sitting in a place and janaza and a funeral passed him by, he stood up. فَقِيلَ لَهُ إِنَّهَا جِنَازَةُ يَهُودِي They told him, "The janaza, this is a funeral of a Jewish man." Rasulullah alayhi salatu wa salam answered back, he says, أَلَيْسَتْ نَفْسَا He said, "Isn't that a soul? Isn't that a soul?" Look at the respect. Look at the qualities of the Muslim. Look at the respect for others. Any person who tells you today, and we could talk about this all day and all night, talk about the generosity, the gentleness, the great demeanor of the Muslims, the preservation of life of the Muslims. We could tell you stories and stories. It's unmatchable in the history of humanity. No people has ever respected life. No people has ever respected the wealth of people. No people has ever preserved the dignity and the respect for people and human life like Muslims, like what Islam orders us to do. Yes, there's some Muslims who make mistakes. We are just like the rest of everybody else. But that is the teachings of Islam. This is what it is. And you could see it in every action, in every word, in every gesture from Rasulullah alayhi salatu wasalam and his Sahaba. What's really catching to this is Rasulullah, when this happened, when the funeral was passing by, they both got up. And they looked at them and said, yeah, but this is just a regular man. He's not a Muslim. He's not, just, you know, whatever. They said, oh, but we saw Rasulullah alayhi salatu wasalam when a funeral passed him by and he knew he's a Jewish man. He says, isn't that enough? Is that a soul? We should be respectful. Look at the obedience of the teachers. And then we should ask ourselves, when somebody walk up to you today, and I would say, Rasulullah alayhi salatu wasalam said this and did this. Sometimes you get the answer is like, yeah, you're right. But how often that you hear is like, are you sure this is hadith sahih? Are you sure? No. That is sunnah. That we could take it, we could leave it. I say, subhanAllah. Look how they obeyed. Look how they listened. And how they were successful. And look how we sit here, we question. We say, what is that this way or whatever? Look at the obedience of the teacher, our doctor, our prophet, our messenger, Rasulullah alayhi salatu wasalam. And look at this following, where it takes you from success, from greatest places. Walhamdulillah. The next hadith, Babu ma yukrahu min ittikhadhi al-masajidi ala al-qubur. This is a book where what is hated, what is disliked, made makruh, disliked, or made it pretty much prohibited, is that for people to make a house of worship or a masjid on top of or where graves are. This is a big, big kabira. This is something disallowed in our deen. Walhamdulillah, 99.9% of the masajid, of the places, houses of worship that the Muslims have, they are free from graves. Unlike some other nations, unlike some other people, who they do it both ways. They bury somebody and they make a house of worship out of it, a church, synagogue, or whatever it is, you know, house of worship. Or the opposite, they bring somebody and they bury him right into the house of worship itself. And I was surprised, I was in Italy, you know, years ago. And I walked in, checking out the churches. I was in the church, and the guy was said, he's the tour guide. He's telling me, yeah, this. By the way, he looks at me. He says, you are standing on top of Dante's grave. I'm like, Dante's grave. Well, closely, like, and I realized, like, man, this is one grave. And people are actually walking on top of them. It's like nothing but a piece of marble engraved the names on these people. Some of them we knew, obviously. Dante, we recognize him. And a lot of them, lost part of our news, who are these people? We, as Muslims, we are prohibited from doing this. That's number one. Number two is, you notice that in Islam, the name for a house of worship is masjid. That's the name. And it signifies a very important fact. Al-Hadith Abu Dharr al-Ghifari radiallahu anhu, he asked Rasulullah, he says, what is the very first masjid, or baytullah? What is the first house Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala built on this earth? Rasulullah said, Al-Kaaba. Masjid, are you the first masjid? Al-Kaaba. He says, which is the next one? He says, Baytul Maqdis, which is in Jerusalem, or, you know, Baytul Maqdis. He says, how far apart? He says, 40 years apart. The very first masjid was Al-Kaaba. The second masjid was in Masjid Al-Aqsa, over the Masjid Al-Aqsa, right? The name of it is Masjid. Masjid is what? Place of sujood, place of prostration. This is the proper way to worship Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. The true humbleness of a human, to humble himself to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, not to kneel with one knee or two knees, not for you to bow, not for you to dance and hold the musical instruments. It's not a way of worshiping. The worship that we know of from the early times is to humble yourself, is for you to prostrate, to put your face on the dirt, on the ground, for the sake of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the al-masjid. This is how we were taught from our Rasul alayhi salatu wa salam. Now, an Aisha, Hadrat Aisha radiallahu anha. Go ahead, yeah.
What about the ayah, وَاتَّخِذُوا مِن مَقَامِ إِبْرَاهِيمَ
مُصَلَّى. This is, subhanAllah, we were talking about this a couple of days ago. We're saying something about musalla. What is musalla? Remember the words salli, yusalli, connection. اتخذوا من مقام إبراهيم مصلى. This is a specific, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala designated specific geographic locations that your connection is stronger, it's more beneficial, more rewardful to you rather than the rest of everyone else. Like what? Al-Kaaba, if you go to the Kaaba, if you go to the Haram, you make one salah, is equal 1,000 salah of anywhere else, except for Rasulullah, except Masjid Hada, except that my masjid. So Rasulullah told us, you don't la tushaddu rihal, you don't make a trip to go to a masjid, except to three masajid. Except three masajid. Which is Al-Masjid Al-Aqsa in Bayt Maqdis, the other one Masjid Nabawi, where Rasulullah in Medina, and third one is in the Kaaba. But inside the Kaaba specifically, there's places where more reward has been given. More places, better connection with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to emulate the people before us like Ibrahim alayhi salam. So you make musalla from it, right? For the connection, for the salah, you see? The proper way. And how do we say the salah between us, sila, the connection between us to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala? Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, the Lord, the creator of all, the creator of the universe, the creator of heaven and earth, the master of time, the Lord of space, the creator of everything, the one who runs everything, and us, the little tiny creature that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala put here on the face of this earth. What is this true connection with Him? To worship Him the way He orders us to worship Him. How? This is the way we see the salah as we see it today. So you make a musalla in the same concept, in the same way. So in this case, when you say تَخِذُوا مَقَامِ إِبْرَاهِيمَ مُصَلَّى, is that for you to make it a place of connection, make it a place of relation to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And how? The way Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala ordered us. How do we make musalla? With sujood, with ruku'. Wallahu a'lam. Barakallahu feek. عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم عائشة أم المؤمنين رضي الله عنها عن النبي صلى الله عليه وسلم قال في مرضه. He said, رسول الله عليه وسلم, he said when he was sick, in that sickness where he passed away. That was, you know, at the time. He says, لعن الله اليهود والنصارى اتخذوا قبور أنبياءهم مساجد. And Allah, Rasulullah says, لعن الله. It's not a dua. Rasulullah is stating a fact. He says, لعن الله اليهود والنصارى. What is لعنة in Islam? Some people translate it as the word damnation or damned, right? And we say, what is the word damn means? And say is that somebody says damnation is somebody who's prohibited or not allowed to enter the heaven. This is what the damnation, this is what the word damn means, right? And you know, and we are prohibited from using this word except when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala or Rasulullah has used it. Rasulullah himself, he says, لست بلعان, and I'm not the one who walks around and says, لعن الله, لعن الله, لعن الله. In Islam, la'an is a little bit different meaning. La'an means that to keep and yub'id Allah al-khayr an hadha al-insan fi hadhi dunya wa fi al-akhirah. La'an means to keep anything good, anything khayr from this person in this earthly life and in the life after. So, to keep anything good happening to us here on the face of this earth, what is la'an means? To keep the rahmah from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala away from somebody, to keep the barakah away from somebody, to keep the goodness away from somebody. Everything Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala give something good, the prevention of this called la'na. And in their life after, what is la'na? It means there's one thing good is going to happen to us other than maghfirah and the forgiveness of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the jannah. So la'na means both, right? So Rasulullah alayhi salatu wasalam says, la'na Allah al-Yahuda wa al-Nasara. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala kept the greatness or the goodness away from the Yahud, from the Jews, and from the Christians, you know, from the ones who follow the Christians, because ittakhadhu quburan anbiya'ahum masajid, they took the graves of their prophets, they made it a place of prostration, places of sujood. We are prohibited strictly in our deen to have a place, a grave of somebody where you prostrate to this somebody, masajid. We are prohibited from doing this. Why? Obviously, the reason is clear. The reason is that there's always a mix-up between, people get mixed up in their minds, between paying respect for the somebody, or the grave of the somebody, or worshipping this somebody. And if you keep both, somebody who deserves the respect at the place where you make salah or you make worship or you make prayer or you make supplication, somehow it gets crisscrossed. And then all of a sudden you're paying respect for the somebody, and then all of a sudden you're making salah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. You're making salah to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, you're paying respect to this guy, and then get mixed up, and that is prohibited. You cannot. This Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is the creator, and the Prophet of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is a messenger from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala who delivered the message, who deserves our respect, deserve our dua, but we don't worship him, we don't make ta'zeem for him. That's why Rasulullah qat'an, and he kind of closed the door on this, he says, you don't build a masjid on top of a grave, right?
Okay,
sure.
So if you're traveling somewhere and you come across a masjid, but it has something like that, somebody's buried there, and then the masjid is separate from it, can you pray there?
Yeah, if it's separate, that's fine. You know, and a lot of ulama, some of them at least, I would say, some of them said that any masjid that has a grave in it, you should not be praying in it. You know, they took it to an extreme. And some others said, because there's something more important, is that for you to make jama'ah in this masjid, it is more important. So, but you got to make sure you stay away from the actual grave, where that grave is. And I've seen it with my own eyes. Some of our brothers, they also tell you the same thing. There is a places, like, you know, for instance, Al-Masjid al-Nabawi, al-Amawi in Damascus. There's a grave in it, and they claim to be is the grave of Yahya, which is John the Baptist. You know, they say he's grave there in the middle of the masjid. This is what they say. And I've seen it with my own eyes. Some people, they actually prostrate, make salah to the grave in a different direction than the Qibla. Different direction, okay. And this is the, I was like, what are you doing? You're making salah to the grave? In the middle of the masjid. The Qibla that direction. And this is the confusing part. If the grave is there, and you are making salah, and the grave is in your way, so somehow, you know, maybe I'll get it. But for you to make, you know, to prostrate different direction, the Qibla is this way, you're making sujood to that direction just because it's the grave, this is act of worship. You're worshiping that grave. This is shirk. What's the difference between this man and somebody who worships a statue? Somebody who worships a picture? What's the difference? There's absolutely none. Well, I mean, this is what it is. Just that makes you with somebody, and it depends on the niyyah. And that's the question here. When we address these people, and people always talk about them, say, what is their true intention? They really don't know, or they're doing it intentionally. They know what they're doing, but they did it anyway. And who really knows what's in their hearts? Allah knows. That's why we cannot ever call somebody kafir. Never. But you can, what you can do is, somebody would describe the actions of others. What do you say? They're like, okay, fine, I don't want to talk about so-and-so, but tell me what he does. He says, well, he prays to a statue. Say, that is the action of somebody who's kafir. You could judge his actions. But we don't know what he's doing. We don't know what's in his heart. Right? We don't know. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows. You look at this guy, you say, you know what? He made wudu with oil. Subhanallah, making wudu. tahara with oil instead of water? What is wrong with this guy? And he'll tell you, this, when you ask me, is this the work or this is the worship of a kafir? I tell you, no. I would tell you, his wudu is not acceptable because we know what the wudu qualification is. And you've got to follow this way. One of the greatest dangers of a person, a Muslim or otherwise, is to start labeling people, not knowing who's what's in their hearts. That's a great danger. You start walking around and say, this guy's kafir, this guy's good, this guy, yeah, you don't know anything from anything. You can barely, you don't even know what's in your heart. You barely know what's in your heart. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala knows. You walk around and you got to find these different groups. This guy's kafir, this guy's this guy's that. Ya akhi, the Rasulullah prohibited us from doing this. But what we should do is question and give advice and do not throw labels at people, especially people you never met, especially people that you hear about, or this guy did this guy did that, and it's so easy for us to stand up and say, oh, that guy's this way, that guy's that way. Ya akhi, worry about yourself. We all know the hadith. Yara al-insanu subhanallah, the human being, yara al-qadh'ata fi aynihi, you know, fi ayni akhi. Yara al-qadh'a, it's like the small splinter. He sees it in the eye of his brother. Wala yara jiz'a fi aynihi, and he does not see the trunk of a tree in his own eye. This is hadith on Rasulullah sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. الإنسان لا يرى القذ يرى القذعة الإنسان the human being, he sees the little splinter in his brother's eye. يرى الإنسان القذعة في عين أخيه ولا يرى جذعة في عينه. سبحان الله. This is what we say. Care about yourself. Look at yourself. Look what you're doing. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, and I assure you this, inshallah, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not going to ask you about what others have done. They will only be asked what you have done, what you have said, about your own actions. You're not a judge, we're not judges. And if you are a judge, if you happen to be, they put you in, there's a country and you're qualified to have the full knowledge of the law, and you're being in that position where you're a judge, and they bring somebody to you with your knowledge, with your expertise, you sit there, the very first thing you gotta do, what do? You question him. You walk up to him and say, what did you do that for? What did you prostrate this way for? What did you make the sujood this way for? What did you say what you said for? And then you inquire from him. If he did it out of ignorance, that's one thing. If he did it out of intention, he knows he's doing it intentionally because of his own faith. You tell him, you realize that's this is the situation you're in. You got to advise him. You got to tell him exactly what he's doing. And then you see his response back. There's a sequence of things you got to do before you label people, right? Wallahu a'lam. So, now.
What about warning people? Say if you deal with somebody and you realize that person is not honest or something is going on, how do you, I mean, if somebody else wants to do the same thing, how do you, can you warn people?
Absolutely. This is actually mandatory upon the Muslims. Al-amr bil-ma'roof wal-nahy anil-munkar. For you to order people to do good and order people to stay away from bad. This is mandatory. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala said in the Quran, He says, كُنْتُمْ خَيْرَ أُمَّةٍ أُخْرِجَتْ لِلنَّاسِ. You are the best ummah. أُخْرِجَتْ لِلنَّاسِ. Have been brought to people. Been to people. And why? Are we better looking than the other people? Are we because we have six sets of arms and they only have two? Do we have 17 eyes and they only have, you know, everybody has two? We are just like everybody else. Why? تَأْمُرُونَ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَتَنْهَوْنَ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ. Why we're good? Why are you the best ummah? Why is the Muslims the best ummah as described in the Quran? Because of one reason. تَأْمُرُونَ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَتَنْهَوْنَ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ. This is it. Because we order people to do good, we tell people to stay away from bad. But how? How do you tell people to do good, and how do you tell people to stay away from bad? In a nutshell, أَنْ تَأْمُرَ النَّاسَ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ. Order people to do good, good way. وَأَنْتَنْهَا عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ بِغَيْرِ الْمُنْكَرِ. For you to order people to stay away from bad, or something that is not bad. Like what? You find somebody doing something bad, you walk up to him, gentle, nice, you give him advice, you tell him the best way you can, ya akhi, this is wrong, you're hurting yourself. You feel, you know, yeah, this is an obligation upon us. You see somebody who is being rough and too rough with his wife, like for instance, for his son, with his son. What do you say? none of my business, I don't care. No, you walk up to him, say, brother, mashallah, this is a beautiful child. You tell him the best advice that you can, right? And if he's not gonna listen to you, if he's not gonna obey you, you know, at least you tried, at least you did your best. But again, look at the other hadith, is that, إِذَا رَأَى أَحَدُكُمْ مُنْكَرًا, if one of you see munkar, something bad, فَلْيُغَيِّرْهُ بِيَدِهِ, change it with his hands. فَإِنْ لَمْ يَسْتَطِعْ, and he cannot, فَلْيُغَيِّرْهُ بِلِسَانِهِ, change it with his tongue. And إِنْ لَمْ يَسْتَطِعْ فَبِقَلْبِهِ, وَذَلِكَ أَضْعَفُ الْإِيمَانِ. You walk in down the street, right? And you hear a woman, doesn't matter, screaming, rape, rape, rape. What do you do? Well, got three choices. You don't have a fourth choice. Choice number one, you look up, you find yourself, you know, mashallah, you're black belt, you know, karate, or you are a police officer, you're trained, you know, you have the abilities. You walk in the house, you stop the one who is making the rape, pull him away, say, you should not be raping, blah, blah, blah. That's it. You're able. If you're just not able and you cannot do it, what do you do? With your tongue, with your mouth. You pick up the phone, 911, somebody help. You scream, rape, rape, somebody being raped, come over, do something. Do something with your tongue. Walk up to the guy, knock on the door. Hey, stop it, and he's gonna come after you. You run, but you're not, you know, you gotta serve yourself. At least you tried. But if you got a gang of 16, 17 people who's doing something back, they're robbing a bank and everybody, you know, got guns on them, and they're going, they're gonna shoot people, what do you do? You say, oh, that is wrong. You cannot interfere, what are you gonna say? You open up your mouth, you're gonna be shot. Or you not only shot, everybody else will be shot. Right? What do you say? You say, oh, that is wrong. That should not be happening. But you know what? There's nothing you can do with your hand. There's nothing you can do with your tongue. So at this point, save yourself. You got to figure out the best you could do. And the fourth choice is not allowed, which is for you not to care. Not caring. It is the biggest problem you could possibly do to yourself, to your community. And this is our problem today, is that we see something bad happening around us, and what do we say? None of my business. I don't care. I only care about myself. I only care about my own affairs. I only care about what's happening to me. I only care about, you know, my own family. That is not the way Islam is. Rasulullah alayhi salatu wasalam warned us from this. لَتَأْمُرَنَّ بِالْمَعْرُوفِ وَلَتَنْهَوْنَ عَنِ الْمُنْكَرِ. You will order people to do good, and you order people to stay away from bad. Oh, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, yusallitu alaykum adhab. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will stick you, will enforce upon you a torture and torment. Torment of what? We pass by, we see the indiscretion, we see the injustice, we see the bad things, we pass by like nothing. There's no better story than the story of Ashabu As-Sabt. The people of the Sabbath, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala told us this story in the Qur'an, what has happened to these people. And inshallah, we'll talk about it further if you want to. We touch up on this inshallah. So, just to finish up here inshallah, قالت, the remainder of the hadith, قالت عائشة رضي الله عنها أم المؤمنين ولولا ذلك لأبرزوا قبره. Without this word, the qabr or the grave of Rasulullah alayhi salatu wasalam, it would have been shown, it would have been outside. You got to remember, the grave of Rasulullah alayhi salatu wasalam, where was Rasulullah alayhi salatu wasalam, where was he buried? In his?
Aisha's room.
Aisha room. Where's Aisha, Umm al-Mu'mineen? Where's her room?
Next to the masjid.
Exactly. His house, or the houses of Rasulullah alayhi salam, you say house, you know, like a castle. Like a 3,000 square feet space. It was just a room. That's it. And the door of this room used to open to the masjid. Abu Bakr as-Siddiq radiallahu anh, when Rasulullah passed away, he says, I heard Rasulullah saying that when he dies or passes away, he would be buried in the spot where he dies. So what they did is that, they lifted his jasad al-mubarak, his blessed body. They lifted it. They removed, you know, his mattress where he was staying, sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And they dug the grave and they buried him right there on the spot. Eventually, The masjid was big. Eventually the masjid got to expand, got to get bigger and bigger and bigger, because now the Muslim ummah is no longer, you know, so many thousands of people. Now it's become 500,000 people, millions of people, right? So people got to visit him. The masjid got expanded many, many, many times. So because of the hermit, Qabr Rasulullah alayhi salatu wasalam, the grave of Rasulullah alayhi salam cannot be moved, cannot be touched. So they kept it where it is, and they had to, because of need and necessity, it was included as part of the Masjid al-Nabawi. But if you notice, they say something here interesting in the tafsir, what he's saying here. وَهَكَذَا قَالَتْهُ عَائِشَةَ قَبْلَ أَنْ يُوَسَّعَ الْمَسْجِدِ وَلِهَذَا لَمَّا وُسِّعَ الْمَسْجِدِ جُعِلَتْ حُجْرَتَهَا مُثَلَّثَةَ. Her room, it was made to be a triangle. It's not a square room, her space that she was in. Because they don't want people to stand up in front of the grave of Rasulullah alayhi salatu wasalam in the direction of the Kaaba and to make salah, and his grave in the middle, in between. And this is the reason why they build it the way they build it today. That's one of the reasons also why you find a lot of security guards, a lot of officers who stand over there. If you're passing by in front of the grave of Rasulullah, they tell you to move, move, move. You can visit, that is the visitation. You can stand there, yes, that's a blessed place. Rasulullah has informed us. The space between the member and his grave, rawdah min riyad al-jannah. It is a place from the Jannah, right? But that's not a place for you to make the dua or think you're going to be blessed more in the space. This is a place for you to pass and for you to go, keep going to the other places. And you, inshallah, and ask Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, for Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala to grant us the true visit and to actually see Rasulullah alayhi salatu wasalam in the Jannah when he's standing there by the hawd, when he's waiting for us, inshallah, we shake his hand, inshallah. We all stand there, we have a drink from his blessed hand that will never get thirsty after we drink from this blessed hand, inshallah, from that blessed drink. And inshallah, we will be in his company in the Jannah. Inshallah, we're going to all enter. Jazakum Allah khair, barakallah fikum jameer. We make dua, inshallah, after the salah. Barakallah fikum jameer.